This podcast has stories of real-life events and true crime that happens every day. These stories may contain adult language and graphic or disturbing details not suitable for everyone. Listener discretion is advised. In our society, most people are content to go through their daily lives safely and peacefully. But our society is not always safe or peaceful. For that reason, some men and women answer a higher calling to defend and protect their fellow man. You probably know someone who is one of these people, or maybe you are one of these people. The ones who see and do the things most people would never want to. These things are sometimes heroic and beautiful, but often they are horrific and terrifying. It's these things they don't share about with other people. It's these things they carry with them, so you don't have to. But when they get together, they talk to each other about them. And they call these stories war stories. Welcome to another episode of War Stories.
Welcome, welcome, welcome.
I'm your host, Fletch Fletcher, and joining me, as always, is my co-host, Zohan. What's going on?
Not much. How you doing?
I'm doing good. I'm just happy to be here on a Sunday. And
me too, getting ready for work tonight. Awesome.
That's right. You're going to crush crime and suppress evil.
Yeah.
And back by popular demand.
Work? What's work?
Right.
Work. I fucking hate you right now.
A listener favorite of Salty. What's happening?
Hello. Nice
welcome.
To be here.
Welcome to your own home.
Thank you. Yeah, you guys keep on showing up. I know I say it every time.
Well, you keep extending the invitation, so we keep showing up.
You have all these microphones on your,
right?
Table.
On your table.
It's like, what do you expect?
And as you hear, giving Salty a ration of shit is JR joining us again.
How you guys doing?
What's going on?
I'm happy.
And
happy to be here.
In our peanut gallery, we have Mrs. Salty.
The peanut gallery.
That's right. And I had to talk you into this.
You did.
I did multiple times.
I think I heard a couple of threats, actually.
We've there was sat some here a couple
months.
Of times.
Months.
Yeah. And so you're here to provide what I like to call color commentary. In other words, as a female and a retired police officer.
Retired, yes.
You can call bullshit on our guyness.
I can call bullshit on these two right here.
What about this one?
Bullshit sure. On our bullshit. Right?
You can call bullshit on Salty.
Wait,
and
what about this one?
I know. Hey, all my shit's legit, bro.
That's
she
right.
Bullshit on you. Yeah. We've all worked together.
I know. So, Zohan, why don't we take care of a little business? People have been reaching out to us, by the way. Out of nowhere, we've been starting to, you know, we're six episodes in at as of the recording of this podcast, we're six episodes released, and people have already been reaching out to us. The feedback's been great. I know, Salty, you've gotten feedback directly from people that have found you through the show.
Yeah. I mean, it seems, what would you say? Probably.
I'd say it's every day.
Daily, yeah.
Yeah.
Daily we're getting feedback on this.
And so those anonymous email accounts I've set up to you, it's all feedback. That's working, is what you're saying. Oh, cool.
You've been a busy boy.
Yeah, cool.
Yeah. And
We're getting a lot of stuff on our Instagram. We're getting a lot of stuff on our Facebook. Both of those, you can follow us at War Stories. That's on Facebook, and then on Instagram is War Stories Official. Getting a lot of feedback on the Instagram. That's on the daily. We just started a Twitter. I am not that great with this Twitter thing.
I'm
however,
teach you.
Fletch is.
Yeah.
So this Twitter.
Oh no, I'm not great at it. I just.
Oh, you just can do it.
I can hit.
Go
tweet
or tweet.
Whatever, tweet. Yeah.
Okay. So, anyways, the Twitter thing's
taken off. I got
all
the Twitters.
You can get us on Twitter at war_stories_pod.
Right.
And
retweet
our stuff.
Because War Stories Official was already taken.
Yeah.
Apparently.
Oh. All right. Well. Really. Retweet our stuff, and we'll retweet yours. And also, we put a. I don't know how to. We have our own phone number.
Yeah,
now.
We have a voicemail line.
Yeah.
Yeah, so we have a voicemail line
if
now.
If you
want to
call
up.
And tell us how good we're doing, how shitty we're doing, if you want to tell us a story about yourself, if you want to be mentioned on the show, you can give us a call. Number 626-692-5122. And we'll mention you on our next podcast.
But don't be like, this one time this guy pulled me over to give me a ticket and he was an asshole.
Right.
We don't.
Right. Or we're going to make our own segment out of you.
Yes, you will.
That will happen.
You know what? Go ahead. Actually, I'm now going to invite you to call in and say that.
And just, to put this out there, we're going to fact check. you know, like if you guys are going to mention something big, which is cool, if you want to mention it, but we definitely want to get our story straight on here and not lie to the people.
Yeah.
Also, you can hit us up by email, www.mailbag.com.
No, it's just mailbag. Sorry,
there's no W's. That's not a website. Mailbag, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, mailbag.warstories@gmail.com.
I don't know computers.
Wow. Yeah. Goes to show you how many computers I mess with. So mailbag.warstories@gmail.com. And that's it.
Okay. And speaking of, we actually have you can contact us virtually every single way imaginable, email, voicemail, Twitter, Facebook. So we actually got a message from Rob. And Rob says, please don't use my last name. But Rob shared his story with us. So I wanted to, he said we could read it. He's had 30 years on a fire department in, I don't even know if I should say the state. I've got the city and state, but I don't want to say it. So let's just say middle America, flyover country.
Rob knows we're talking about him.
Rob knows we're talking about him. So Rob, you've had 30 years on the fire department and you shared a story with us and you said we could read it. So he said, Rob says, here's one of my stories. It's true. I was there. One of those you can't make this up stories. And, you know, that's what the show's based on.
Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and say right now this is a lie because every war story starts out with you no can't. Shit. Right. There I was. Okay, so I Rob's a liar.
Niagara Falls.
I'm still thinking of 30 years of dragging hose.
Right. Ooh, right. Man. Ooh, dragging hose or dragging hose?
S-E, not E-S.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Just double checking. Yeah. So Rob says, I was on a small rural fire department late one night. We got called out for an accident in the S-curve by the airport. I'm assuming there's an S-curve by the airport. So all right. we're with you. Upon arrival, we found a car. Oh, my God. This is a – it's you can tell it's report writing 101. Yeah. Upon arrival. upon arrival, we found a car on its side in the grass after the first curve. The really bad part was that there was a large tree in the center of the grass. When the car entered the curve, instead of following it, it went straight. It went airborne, twisted 90 degrees, driver side up, and impacted the tree at the windshield. Ooh. The tree. Yeah, this just, like, having been to enough TCs, I can tell you, I can just
totally picture this.
Totally picture it. Right. The tree broke both of the A posts and stopped at the B posts. The car hit the tree about 6 feet up from the ground and slid down. The male driver was still in the driver's seat. One of the medics climbed up the underside of the car to check his vitals and found he was deceased.
Go figure.
As one would expect. Okay, right. Okay, so we're you know. I found he was deceased. The coroner was called, and we pried the roof back and eased the car over to its wheels. The coroner had us help him remove the driver and place him in the basket stretcher. The coroner did a cursory exam of the body and found the driver's left foot freshly missing. We searched the debris field and couldn't find the foot. One of the one of these days I'll share my TC story that's similar, but find a foot that was freshly missing. We searched the debris field and couldn't find the foot. One of the guys was staring at the car and saw a small sliver of denim poking out of a crack in the metal under the driver's door. We pried the door the crack open with a Halligan, and there it was. In the crash, the crack had opened up, his foot went in, and then it closed, severing it. So it opened a crack and closed. Wow. So the car scissored his foot off, I guess. We also found a – this is where it gets good. We also found a male – well, that was good too. A male passenger stuffed under the dashboard.
What?
We pulled him out, and he unfolded like a rag doll. The coroner declared him deceased as well. But wait, there's more.
Oh, Jesus.
Just as the coroner was zipping up the bag on the passenger, someone said – hey, what's that at the base of the tree? The coroner walked over and looked. Oh, there it is. I kind of wondered where his brain went, he said. He found an empty cassette zipper case laying nearby and dropped the brain in it and put it in the bag with the owner.
wow.
This is
really, you can't make this show.
Yeah. Really from is. Rob, yeah. Please don't use my last name.
Right.
So, folks, you can't make this stuff up at all.
And then we went back to the fire station and had spaghetti and root beer floats.
Right. That's right. It's always spaghetti root beer floats, guys.
Wow.
So if you don't believe that somebody can be turned into cheesecake topping by a wood chipper, there's an email from a listener that confirms that cops and firefighters see
some of the most god-awful shit imaginable.
And figure out a way to laugh about it.
Yeah.
Well, because if you don't, yeah, what's the alternative?
Yeah, that's true.
You know, I mean, we always joked we had a CAPS team, you know. We had these shirts, C-A-P-S, and it was consuming alcohol prevents stress. Mm. So, you know. Was it the Choir Boys?
Yes.
Right? That's what we used to call it. Mm-hmm. If somebody ever tells us we can't use the War Stories podcast name anymore, I'm just going to start calling it Choir Practice, because that's basically what we're doing here.
Yeah, pretty much.
And for those of you who don't know, an LAPD copper by the name of Joseph Wambaugh became an author and started writing. I think his first book was True Crime about the Onion Field, Carl Hettinger and Ian Campbell.
Yep.
And then he subsequently wrote books that were fictionalized versions of real stories and real people that he had known. And one of those was called The Choir Boys, and was based on a police practice of getting off work and all getting together for a drink afterwards at an undisclosed location and debriefing the horrible shit you'd seen that night on your shift, right? Only, unfortunately, a lot of times because you got, you know, cops off duty drowning their sorrows in a free bottle of booze from the local liquor store, you generate more stories out of that choir practice than you actually did working. So that practice kind of went under. It still occurs, though. It's just on the down low?
Absolutely not.
No,
none of that occurs anymore.
That ended after first book.
That's not anymore. That book kind of ruined it for everybody.
Ruined it for everybody. Yeah. I actually had training officers who knew the real names of some of the characters.
Really?
In that movie. Because, I mean, you figure that's 25 years ago.
Right.
And then they would have been young policemen when these guys were doing their shenanigans.
Yeah. The movie's actually, I mean, it's old and it's hard to find, but it's, you know, Charles Durning and some of those other guys. I can't even remember off the top of my head, but it had a good cast. It was a good movie.
Hey, you know, I just thought of something. Didn't we go and arrest?
Yeah, we had a UC operation.
A UC operation to take that shithead back into custody
for
one of the Onion Field murders?
We did.
Really?
Yeah.
So
he was in downtown LA, and we ran a UC. Didn't we?
Yeah, we did.
It was him, wasn't it? I can't remember his name.
Oh God, I wish I could remember.
But anyway, he had gotten out, and he was in one of those hotels in downtown LA, and we ran an operation to get a buy into him to get his fucking ass back in jail.
Fuck yeah.
Yeah.
Only in California would he be out in the first place.
No, I think he got a ticket.
The restorative justice at its finest.
This is your ticket for 187 PC.
Right.
Please, I'm just checking the to be booked booking required prior to to.
Well, of course. It was a cop. Had it been a normal human being or a regular.
Right.
I said normal human being. That was a Freudian slip.
Exactly.
Had it been a normal human being, he would have actually been arrested.
You know, I mean, and if you go back to that, all really important decisions in police work stem from, you know, we all have already talked about this. We debrief tragedies, and that's how we learn. And, you know, two of the things that we learn from that, obviously, one is don't ever give up your gun. But two, I think the LAPD itself learned a lesson, because what they did with Carl Hettinger after that, because for those of you who don't know, Ian Campbell, Carl Hettinger in the 40s, they were taken, was it 40s or 50s? I can't remember. Maybe early 50s.
50s.
Early 50s, yeah. They were taken captive and driven out to an onion field in Bakersfield. And Ian Campbell, young police officer with, you know, I think a pregnant wife at the time, was shot and killed. Carl Hettinger, while his partner was shot, was able to run and escape and hide in the onion field until he was able to get home and the Good Samaritan discovered him. And the longest trial in LA history, blah, blah, blah. But what the LAPD did at the time, and not many people know this, they made Carl Hettinger go station to station, roll call to roll call, and retell the story.
Yeah.
And then tell everybody, don't do what I did because you'll get your partner killed.
Hmm.
So the policy became don't ever give up your gun as a result of Carl Hettinger having given up his gun. Hmm. And then you make that guy, you re-traumatize him over and over. Carl Hettinger ended up, I think, a security guard at a department store and got popped for kleptomania because he became a thief because he just cracked under all that pressure. So it's terrible, but we learn tough lessons about how to handle, you know, critical incidents just by fucking somebody up in the process.
Sure. I think that's him, isn't it?
Did you find him?
Well, it's saying he died.
In prison.
Oh, good.
In prison.
Yeah, so he did go back.
You guys killed him?
Okay. Oh. Yeah, he died of cancer in prison. Too bad.
Okay, let's all... No, we're done. Moving on. We don't care about him. So we have JR back.
Hi. Sorry.
No, great.
Everybody else canceled. All the cool kids couldn't show up today.
I lured you in with Bloody Marys.
Right. Bloody Marys, right. That's what it was.
Right. I was told there would be Bloody Marys.
Scooby Snacks. So you're here, and last time you shared with us a Marine story, and I have no idea what you're going to share with us today, but...
I haven't made it up yet, that's why.
Okay, so, well, yeah. I'm they're much better when they're made up on the spot, because then our reactions are genuine.
Yeah, exactly.
Right, yeah. You know. Strong drinks and true lies. Hashtag strong drinks and true lies.
Nice.
So, JR, what's your story?
So there I was. No shit. See, I told you that earlier. That's the way all good stories start, right? You ain't going to believe this.
Minding my own.
Yeah, minding my own goddamn business. That is straight from the deer story.
Yeah, really?
I need a bambalance. let's just tell that story.
You know what? Haven't heard it, Google.
Yeah. Oh, yes.
Who gets
please,
the deer?
Please let everyone know.
Yes. Who gets the deer? Me or the dog?
Me or the dog? That is classic.
Yes. If you haven't heard it, it's on YouTube. It's all over the internet. Google the deer and the ambulance story, and it's a guy calling the police. And the gist of it is, I need a motherfucking ambulance.
That is the funniest thing I've ever heard.
This is Joe.
And you know what? After what? 25 years, it's still one of the funniest things I've ever heard.
It's painful. I literally laugh so hard my face hurts every single time.
Then I will bring in, if I can get it, I will bring in dispatch audio of a guy from Pakistan calling our department, and I was dispatched to the call, and I happened to be in dispatch when the call was coming in, and I knew it was going to be my call, and I'm watching the dispatcher can't handle this phone call anymore and hands it over to the senior officer on duty, who then picks up the phone and handles, and I'm watching her, and she's like, just go. So I get back to handle the call, get back to the station, and they play me the audio call, and I'm going to do my best impression of the call, but eventually if I can get the audio, I will share it with you. Is the guy calls in, he's Pakistani, he's an immigrant, and he's one of those immigrants you root for, right? He came here properly, came here legally, he's trying to work three jobs to make it, you know, and his piece of shit white trash neighbors are tweakers. And they're constantly giving him shit and causing him problems. So he finally is fed up over a parking space dispute and calls us. And it's I'm going to do my best. So when he's talking to the guys he's having a problem with, he's just jacked up. And then as soon as he talks to the 911 operator, he's totally code four, right? Or, you know, he's totally calm.
He becomes tech support.
Right. Yeah. So it's like, and I kid you not, it's ring, ring, ring. I'm going to fuck you up. Hello. Yes, sir, how can I help you? Yes, I need the police come. Fuck you, motherfucker! I need the cops come right now because there will be a problem with this Dan fucker and this Zach fucker. Fuck you, you fucking druggist! You don't love this great country? I love it! 6805 Main Street,
oh my God.
Apartment 20. Fuck you! I will bring it in. It is literally almost 10 minutes of that.
Have you tried Control-Alt-D?
Well, now that we've digressed,
okay.
Let's have strong drink and true lies.
There I was. I was asleep. Okay. So, gosh, I don't remember how long ago this was, but, you know, in my line of work, you know, guys that wear, you know, body armor, stuff like that, we always talk about the big one, right?
Right.
You know, can't wait for the big one. Can't wait for the big one because, you know, that's well, that's how you end up on a podcast telling the stories, because you go to the big one, right? Otherwise, there I was. It was really boring and nothing happened.
Yeah, okay. No good story started out this one time when I was sober.
Yeah, right? So, you know, we get dispatched to a call, and it was at a major department store in near the airport in downtown Los Angeles. Or that's not – I guess that's the west side.
Yeah, west side.
Yeah, whatever. Yeah. So the story – and I'll kind of work backwards a little bit, because the story starts out that – officers in that division get dispatched to this store because there's a robbery in progress, a 211 in progress. So as you can imagine, like most department stores, the front of the store is glass, you know, glass doors, glass windows, so you can see in and see their wares and, you know, get attracted and sucked in to buy the stuff.
And just for our listeners, so you understand, when a 211 in progress comes out, it's like when a dog sees you grab the treats from the cupboard and they just start wiggling.
Oh, yeah.
Right?
Oh, yeah.
The dog just starts wiggling because he knows the treats are coming. So when the 211 in progress comes out, everybody just starts wiggling.
Yeah, these guys didn't wiggle.
Oh.
So, coppers get there, right? And they pull up in front, and they see a large male Negro. Can we say Negro anymore, or is it male black?
I think male black.
Used to be Negro.
Yes,
used to be. You had to, and then that became not cool, so it's male. It's still male black, right?
I think it's
male.
Okay. I know it's not color. African-American.
I don't think you're allowed to even say anymore.
You can't even say wife beater anymore. I got written up a year ago for saying wife beater.
In reference
in
of
a description.
A person or clothing?
No, in reference to the tank top?
Tank top, yeah.
Oh.
Yeah. Okay. Well, so male black.
Okay. Yeah. And he has a female around the neck. And she's naked except for her underpants. Can we say underpants? Wow. And he's dragging her into the depths of the store.
So he's outside about to drag her in, or they're already
inside the store? Okay. They're seeing her
through the glass. Oh, got it.
Okay. Yeah, the coppers are outside looking at this going on in front of their faces. Now, you, me, we would go, fuck this. We're going to do something about this, right?
Yeah.
They went, key the radio and go, this is what we see. And they stood there.
What year was this?
This was probably 5 years ago, 6 years ago.
Oh, no shit.
Yeah, yeah, right?
That makes sense.
Yeah, exactly.
Total sense.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I mean, not drive your car through the window, break it all out, and take care of your business, shoot the guy.
Right.
Do something, even if it's wrong, right? They did nothing. They just let this happen.
Oh, shit.
On a little side note, we find out later that they took her in the back and raped her.
After?
They saw.
Yes.
While police were there.
Sure.
Yes.
Yeah. Why not?
Yes. Okay. Anyway.
Job ain't for everybody.
Sorry about the bummer, guys. Okay.
Welcome to Los
Angeles. So this turns into a hostage takeover.
Yeah.
Right? Okay. So we don't know how many employees are in the store, you know, but they all basically get taken hostage.
Now, do you know that there's this one person?
Don't get ahead. No, go ahead.
At that point, they only knew there was one.
At that point, we know one and one. So we call that the count. Right. What's the count? One and one. One hostage, one suspect.
Okay. Baseball.
So yeah, sure. What we get is the count.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And ironically enough, we do right hand is good people because they're right, and left hand is bad people.
Well, left hand is always associated with evil.
I'm left handed. Watch yourself. So
I knew there was a reason,
right? Right. So basically, you know, we get dispatched, and you know, hostage situation, this, that, and the other thing. We get some of the details. We don't get those details because, you know, that's not really known at the time. We find out later that a car left the place and was gone, and officers were going to go in pursuit, and they were told by the watch commander, no, don't pursue.
Shocking.
Well, and I'm getting ahead of myself, but those were the bad guys, right? The bad guys are gone.
Let me blow the dust off of my surprised face.
Go ahead. Right. So, okay, so we get there. We set up containment. We have a couple entry teams. We got some guys in the underneath in a parking structure, put an explosive charge on a fire door. I mean, this is like
fun shit.
This is like you find all that SWAT shit that you've been carrying around in your car forever, and you use all of it. We're going to use all this stuff tonight, right? Yeah. So, I mean, we're figuring out how we're going to get through these glass doors. Are we going to break them? Are we going to rake them? What are we going to do? How are we going to do this? Well, we got keys. So that worked out pretty good. So
it's almost a bummer.
I know. It's like, damn. I was getting ready to, you know, cause like thousands of dollars worth of damage to the front of this place.
I'm going
to
use all the SWAT tools.
Yeah, right. So we set up what we call an emergency rescue team. So like if something happens, it's going to push us in there. We're ready to go, man. That's where the charge is for. We're going to rake these windows out. We're going to step in. We're going to do our thing.
Can you explain break and rake real quick?
Yeah, you break it and then you rake it.
Right, but they don't. So what's the raking part?
So basically you take whatever heavy metal thing you can find laying around. Mm-hmm. It could either be a rock or a stick or whatever. And you break the glass and then you rake the frame. So if you can imagine, start in one corner, go up, go around, so that there's no broken glass left in that frame, so that when you stick your body through there, you don't sever your fingers and, you know, bleed to death.
Right.
Yeah. But when you're going to break and rake tempered glass, it rakes itself.
Right.
As soon as you hit it, it just falls out, and it's just awesome. So so we're ready, man. Plans in place. We're ready to go. If this thing's going to step off, you know, we're going to go in and handle business. So everything kind of slows down, and we realize, okay, it's not going to go.
Right.
So we're going to do what's called a stealth probe. And that is not a porn term, right?
I was going to say.
I could have had that one time.
Sneak right in.
Doctor said you're 40. It's time.
Yeah. There was no stealth there.
Grab the edge of the bed.
The stealth was my age sneaking up on me. Yeah.
Blow out. So we had just gotten night vision goggles at the time. So There was literally four of us that had night vision. I was one of the guys that had night vision at the time. So we say, hey, what we're going to do is we're gonna crack the doors. We're going to step in, and we're just going to systematically start clearing this department store in the dark under night vision. So there's four of us online, and everybody else is kind of spread out behind us, and we're kind of moving through this store. You don't know where these guys are. I mean, we think they're still there, hidden under these clothing racks. I mean, and
anywhere.
This is a huge department store, anywhere.
Right?
And it's
can you explain, so the NVGs that you guys used, was it a single eye or was it two?
So we had just gotten binocular. So okay. Two. Yeah.
Okay. So, and I'm only asking this because I've run operations with them, and I would think, and I've never been in a department store with them, but how your depth perception is got to be altered immensely because of all the things in the store.
Oh yeah.
Right.
So go ahead.
Oh no. So basically I was going to ask, just to, can you explain that a little bit? Because when I use them, or use them, I was going into mud huts, and there wasn't like furniture everywhere. There wasn't clothes everywhere. There
it was
pretty
a big empty
open
room.
Rooms.
With
yeah,
mats
yeah.
On
so
the floor.
Can you kind of just
so not to get into the weeds too much. Yeah. But normally, what we would do at the time, and we've kind of segued a little bit, is we would focus one for up close, like almost like arm's distance, and then focus one out to infinity.
Got it. Okay, that's why I'm asking.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then we use infrared lasers for illumination. Mm-hmm. So. To get on the technical term, what night vision does is it doesn't actually allow you to see in the dark.
Right.
If you go into a completely dark environment like a bank vault,
yeah.
You're not going to see shit.
It's right. Be dark.
Because all they do is amplify whatever light is visible.
Correct.
Right.
In whatever spectrum. So that's why we use the infrared lasers. It's basically like an infrared flashlight.
Right.
So we're working our way through this place, lighting it up with almost like infrared flashlights.
Got
but
it.
There's also ambient light,
sure.
So it's magnifying that a little bit. But, when you look under, these clothing racks and stuff, if the guy's there, you're not going to see him
right.
because there's
right.
no light there.
Right.
So I'm scared shitless, basically, is what I'm getting at. Mm-hmm. So we're pushing through this place, very slowly, and it's a foreign environment. It's not like a training venue that you've been in before where you go, okay, I know when I turn this corner, there's going to be a door there. It's,
right.
It's a completely foreign environment. And
actually, not to interrupt you, but the guys behind you probably see even less.
They see nothing.
They see nothing.
They see
so
basically
the shit
our
hits the fan in front
moving.
Of you.
Yeah.
What are they seeing?
So the tactic, for lack of a better term, is if you engage someone, you switch to white light.
Mm. Oh, gotcha. Yeah.
So we're gonna go white them white light and then flashbangs and that whole thing
see.
And now the whole it's going hot
oh,
for lack
it.
Of a better term.
Okay.
So at that point, it won't matter.
That makes
right.
sense.
Yeah.
Got it.
So we're pushing through, and like I said, the nods and our lasers were new to us. I mean, we had only had a few training days, and it's kind of hinky. I stepped into the the dressing room area,
right?
And what's in dressing rooms?
Yeah, mirrors,
mannequins,
full length mirrors.
Yeah,
I almost shot myself.
Yeah,
I'm kidding. But I stepped in, and that laser hit that mirror. Man, I was like, "Holy oh, that's me."
That suspect's good looking.
Yeah, strike a pose a little bit. I'm like, oh,
he's dressed like me.
Yeah, take a selfie. No, so we pushed through, and unbeknownst to us, at this same time, the victims have all been put somewhere together. One of them had a cell phone. So they've called 911, and they're trying to describe to the 911 operator what has transpired and where they are. So at this point now, we've pushed through the public area, for lack of a better term, of the store, and now we're going to step into the back of the store, like where they store all the stuff that's not out, the clothes,
all
the
extra stuff,
and yeah,
in, where the warehouse, office, the inventory,
yeah, exactly where the offices are and everything else. So just about the time we crack those doors, now that area is lit. So, okay, flip the nods up, the pucker factor is not so much because you can see what's going on around you. We hear screaming. I mean, screaming like somebody's being killed screaming. So now we're going to go dynamic. We're raking windows out. We're prying doors off the hinges. We use something called shot lock, which is basically a frangible 12-gauge shotgun round that we shoot the door locks off.
Avon,
yes. In the old days, you just dated yourself.
Yeah.
So, I mean, we're going full hostage rescue, right? I mean, we are doing our thing, right? And it is, well, you know, it's really hard to walk with an erection, but I did my best. I mean, we're banging the doors. We're shooting fucking doors off. It is just awesome, right? So we find the hostages, right? And they're all in a bathroom, and they're all naked. But we found them, right? So good to go. So to back up a little bit, we work off intel. Remember I told you the count, okay? So right. We have figured out now that there's a certain number of hostages that are somewhere, all right? None of the hostages were male blacks. We were told no male blacks are hostages.
Okay.
The suspects, on the other hand, are male blacks.
Right. Mm.
So first guy steps into the room where all the hostages are being held. First thing he sees?
Male black.
Male black. Front kicks the shit out of him and drops him to his knees right there. Yeah. Right? Awesome.
Yeah.
Unbeknownst to everybody, one of the workers had called in sick, and a male black came in and worked for him. So we just fucking drop kicked him. Oh. Just, right. Hey, but he was just happy to see us.
Yeah, he
right?
didn't give a shit.
He was happy to see us. Right?
Shit happens.
So, you know, we finish up. We probably do about, I don't know, $30,000, $40,000 worth of damage to the back of the store.
As one does.
As one does, as you must. And then we find out, hey, you know, nobody's hurt. Well, except the guy we front kicked. but, you know, why are we guys screaming? What was going on? They go, oh, well, we were on the phone with the 911 operator, and she said that the police are looking for you, so you guys scream so they can find you.
Nice. Yeah. Nice.
Can't make this shit up.
What?
Folks. Yeah. Yeah, 911 operator told her to scream. Told them to scream so we could find them. We found them.
Yeah, well,
I mean,
worked.
Yeah, we did
our
thing.
Can't fault their logic, yeah. I guess.
We did our thing. I mean, I would have said, hey, say, we're over here. Right. Yeah, we're over here. Or knock on the door.
Here,
yeah,
present,
do something.
Ollie, Ollie Oxen, yeah, anything but blood-curdling murder screams.
Yeah, yeah. So, wow. You know, the coolest part, though, is that, you know, I think a lot of cops, like if maybe like you're a street cop, you try to keep count of maybe like your felony arrests, and you say, okay, you know, over the course of my career, I made 500 felony arrests or whatever. And that's like an achievement factor. Like,
right.
I imagine like sports guys are like,
it's like RBIs.
Yeah. Whatever that is.
Yeah.
RIPs,
I don't know.
Yeah. So they keep track of it. Right. So I think as SWAT cops, we like to keep track of our hostages. You know, how many lives did you participate in actually saving?
Sure.
You know,
I see that.
How many hostages did you put your hands on? And these people are alive because you did your thing.
Right.
So up until this point, I think my count was like 5 or 6. Because, you know, you get ones and twos.
Yeah.
Well, when there's 18 people that are working in that store, you go from mediocre to fucking rock star in one call up, dude.
It's like
the hostage lottery.
26, like right now. Puff out. You know, you walk around. And then you realize that you didn't really save anybody because the fucking suspects have been gone for like 3 hours.
Oh wait. Mm-hmm. So let's back up then. You were, when patrol arrived.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Suspects were on scene.
Yes.
And patrol saw the suspects taking the hostages with their own two eyes.
Yeah, they saw the one female.
At least one.
Which they actually ended up raping, yes.
Right. Mm-hmm. And did nothing.
Did nothing.
Except observe and report, which I wasn't there, so I won't. I'll leave it there.
Okay.
Then, when you guys finally get there and you get the situation handled.
You're leaving out a very important part.
Oh.
They also saw a vehicle leave at a high rate of speed.
And that watch commander said, no,
called
it
right.
off.
No pursuit. I apologize. Go back and set up containment. Yes. Yeah.
So the vehicle leaves. They just go back, set up containment. Mm-hmm. Don't take the vehicle away.
Yeah, so basically you have useless in the field and you have useless back at the office.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, that's good. It works.
Yes.
But may I suggest that we're giving them what they're asking for?
Oh, absolutely.
The citizens of Los Angeles no longer want police work.
Yes.
That's the bottom line.
Yeah, that's true, too.
That you bring up a valid point. A lot of citizens, I'm sure, New York, Chicago, the poor cops in Baltimore, you know.
Well, I'm gonna kind of disagree a little bit, because I think the people that don't want it are that vocal minority.
I agree.
Okay,
I agree.
I'll give you that.
You're right.
Like if you went door to door.
Okay.
The vast majority
would tell you yes. But the people that have a platform, ACLU, those are the people that don't want us. I mean, we see that right now in South Los Angeles, where there were 29 shootings in the course of a week.
Yeah. There's rolling gun battles.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you have the ACLU saying, get Metropolitan Division out of the South.
We don't want Metro down there anymore.
Stop doing traffic stops. Go to the park and do kitty days. And when you go knock on Mrs. Jones's door, she says, where's the police? Mm, you know, I want them back here. And so So I think you're right, because that's the appearance, because there's that vocal minority that don't reflect the majority of the good people of the city. You know,
so it's the 80-20 rule, just on a different... We always say we deal with, 20% of the population as police officers, but we deal with them 80% of our time.
Yeah.
But this is 80% of the population probably agrees with what the police are doing and want them to do it. The problem is they're not speaking up and telling the other 20% of the whiners to shut the fuck up.
Yeah, you don't represent us.
Right.
Yeah,
right.
Exactly. And go fuck yourself.
And if you look, it seems to be there's a common thread of the people that don't want the police doing their job have ties to people that have a vested interest in not wanting the police to do their job.
Yeah, that's true.
You know, if you're a shithead and you do shithead things, it's very easy to say, oh, you know, the police are being mean and this and that and the other thing. And those 18 hostages, I'm sure, would say you guys did a great fucking job.
Right.
Even if the large major chain store says, dude, that's $40,000 worth of damage. Yeah, but 18 people didn't die.
Right.
And if you want to, if you want to lay the rape at anybody's feet, I can give you some badge numbers.
Yeah. Well, the story, the next phase of that story is we actually did a follow-up to where we found out that car went, and we recovered a gun, and eventually, through some good follow-up work by one of our major divisions that handles homicides and robberies, or robberies and homicides,
right?
They actually caught suspects.
Oh, okay. It does have a good...
Yeah, caught one of them in Dallas, Texas, and caught one of them getting on a bus to go to points unknown, and then found out that it was an inside job.
They were tied to the department store?
So one of the employees was connected to the suspects and actually let them into the store.
Wow.
They knew what time the store closed, went down to the the emergency exit or the employee exit or whatever, and let them in.
So did they actually make off with... I mean, was it an inside job to commit rape, or was
I think that was ancillary.
Okay.
Rape her. Whatever the cash take for the day was, whatever that store would have taken in for the day, or I don't know the business operations of the place, but that's the way it worked. Is they knew, hey, this is the room where the cash is stored at this time of day. This is when they close the front doors. I'll let you in the back door, kind of a thing, and this is kind of sparking my memory a little bit, is the way the whole thing started off was, remember I talked to you about there was one of the victims had a cell phone.
Right.
Well, her significant other was there to pick her up at the end of the day because the store was closed.
Okay.
And she texted her boyfriend, husband, whatever it was, and said, hey, this is what's going on. So that's how the whole thing started off.
Wow.
Because had that not happened, it would have been a done deal. Yeah,
right. In and out.
In and out.
No 211 call, nothing like that.
Yeah, no nothing. So they would have eventually got themselves out of the bathroom somehow, I assume. But,
the next morning when people showed up for work.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Unless all those people were scheduled to work the next day, and then
they're already there.
Yeah, ready to go.
Okay. You guys have been here all night. Great.
Was that the Costco? Was that the Costco shooting where they were in?
Oh, in Van Nuys?
No. Oh. Out in Downey.
Oh,
they made entry into and waited for them to open in the morning and took over the Costco. It was a massive shootout.
Oh, yeah.
With Downey PD. Yeah. And that was several years ago. I'm dating myself.
Right. No, I remember that one. Yeah. I remember
that was with the chase car or they had a van waiting.
Yeah,
in the front, something like that.
It's amazing. I mean, if these shitheads like dedicated half of the energy that they use to bad guy stuff to actually like getting a job, they'd be gainfully employed,
right? Mm. Right.
It's strange how that works.
But the big question is here: the officers that saw this start and just reported it and didn't do anything, did they get the Medal of Valor?
Maybe the life-saving medal.
Life-saving medal.
Yeah. I don't know.
I'm just curious.
I don't know. Not to go off on a complete tangent, but
why not?
Okay, why not? That's why we're here.
That's why we're here.
We should call this war tangents, not war stories. But in this day and age, in this environment that we live in, law enforcement, I guarantee you, the first thing that comes into these, especially these young coppers' minds, is, am I going to get in trouble?
Right.
If I do something, those guys they probably thought, if I break this window and run into this store, am I going to get in trouble for doing this? So, yeah, you can look at them and go, those of us between five of us, that we probably got like 150 years of law enforcement experience sitting here.
It's up there.
We would all say, this is what I would do.
Right.
But with a guy with 2, 3, 4, 5 years on the job who's been programmed to, you know, everything he does could potentially get him in trouble.
Right.
I think that's what they think about first, is they think about their right. career, they think about their house, they think about how am I going to put my kid through college. And
but that's why people like us don't fit in anymore.
That's true.
But there's also, I've noticed, especially with bigger agencies as well, is, you know, patrol is seen as, oh, you've been on the job for 25 years and you're yeah. still working patrol. What's right. wrong with you?
And that's wrong.
And it's terrible. That's, you're okay. Right. So a lot of these agencies, guys get 2, 3 years on, they're eligible for a special assignment. They start, you know, oh, I'm going to go work dope. I'm going to go work kitty rape. I'm going to go work homicide. I'm going to go work, you know, whatever. And they go to these special details after, you know, 3 years, 4 years on the street because they can. And they don't want to be seen as, you know, incapable, and you got to do special assignments, blah, 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 blah. And then they get there, they stay there, they make a home there, they get comfortable. So patrol is staffed with nothing but people fresh off probation or mm-hmm. people on training. And you don't, you know, that grizzled, salty old Bumper Morgan veteran who's got hash marks from his wrist to his elbow doesn't show up on a call and go, listen, kid, here's what we're doing. And if anybody has a problem with it, you tell them to come see me.
Yeah, well, you know, and just to back that up with statistics, our department recently had a detective's test, which historically is an inside job. And then shortly thereafter, they had a sergeant's test, which is a patrol job.
Right.
About 2,000 people took the detective test. 800 took the sergeant's test.
Wow.
Wow.
Yeah. So if that doesn't send a signal, you right. know, to the department to basically say, we understand how you treat people in patrol.
Right.
And we want no part of it.
Right. We want out.
But these inside jobs where I have all day to make a decision, you know, and none of them are life and death decisions, mm-hmm. Sign me up, you know, and that's unfortunate.
Yeah.
You know, not to hop a story on a story.
No,
a very short story. That's exactly what you said was years ago I was in, and you'll know what this is. Was it called MacTac?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So it's still called MacTac, isn't it?
It's still called MacTac.
Yeah, it is.
I'll tell you the story about that later.
So basically it's training where you have, you know, everybody from different jobs, different divisions, all gets together in one place. It's put on by a tactical division in my department, my old department. And they break you up into groups, and you could have one group of five people that could be a lieutenant, it could be a sergeant, it could be three officers, it could be five officers and one sergeant. It's just random, right? You're broken up into groups, and you go over these scenarios, and then there's training and all that also. But you go over these scenarios. You're given a scenario. Your table is given a scenario, and then they come back later and they say, "Hey, so how would you address this scenario?" So, I'm at a table with two lieutenants, a sergeant, an officer, mm-hmm. and myself. I'm a officer also.
So this is what a tabletop exercise, basically.
Yeah. Okay. And so we're given a scenario, and without getting too specific, it's basically a major university here in Los Angeles that gets taken over. The library gets taken over, and there's multiple suspects. They go into the library. And right away, they start killing people, killing students in the library. And they're starting to fortify the doors and the windows.
So it's essentially Columbine at UCLA.
Yeah, okay. Pretty much.
Yeah.
Right?
Okay.
And so you're on scene, and you get there.
Okay.
And this is our scenario. What do you do? The two lieutenants and the sergeant say that we are setting up a perimeter.
And establishing a command post.
And we are establishing a command post, and we're calling SWAT. And so I said, okay, well, if I understood the scenario correctly, you could hear the shots going off and people screaming. They're, right. Who knows how many people are in, it's, you know, massive university library. They're killing people left and right. And the longer we wait, they're fortifying the place, which is going to make it harder on SWAT.
Right.
Right. And now I'm thinking explosives. I'm thinking all kinds of shit. Yeah. Right. Well,
I like the way you think.
Right. Yeah. So they asked me, well, what would you do? The first black and white, I'm going to load up and I'm driving right through the fucking doors.
Right.
Nope.
Well, that's a traffic collision. So you'd take days for this.
Yeah, for sure.
For sure. Days.
So we get into an argument at the table and I'm thinking, there's no fucking way. Yeah. Are you kidding me? There's not going to be anybody left alive in there. Number right. one, by the time SWAT gets here.
Right.
And number two, these guys are now going to have to make an entry in a place that's fucking booby-trapped.
Yeah.
Right? Are you fucking kidding me? People are dying. Yeah, you're insane. And this is why you're not in patrol, he tells me.
What?
And I'm like, fuck. Thank God I'm not in patrol. The point being is that, anyway, let me fast forward a little more. One of the instructors comes and asks, okay, so what did you come up with? Clearly, figure it out, I was right. But the point is that these are the people that are running the show.
Right.
The lieutenants and the sergeants are the ones that are telling the officers what we're going to do, how we're going to do it, and when we're going to do it.
Yeah, the same guy that says, do not pursue.
The same guy that's going to let your kid and your daughter and your son die in there.
Right.
Yeah. So.
Well, okay, so let's go back a little bit for the listening audience.
I think it's put on Metro. Was it MACTAC put on
Metro? So originally it was.
Sorry.
So, no, it's okay. So MACTAC is multi-assault counterterrorism action capabilities.
See, you can't make this stuff up. I do.
Yeah. I love this guy.
Yeah, cops, right? And their acronyms. Yeah.
I have it on my hand.
Cops, military, anybody. We just love our acronyms.
Yeah, I'll tell you. They actually made up the acronym first, and then they had to figure out what that make the letter stand for.
You're kidding.
No, I'm serious. It's a heart attack. So
I believe it.
When the department came out with this capability, it was after the Mumbai incident in India.
Yes.
Like, hey, we got to figure out a way to address this. So we basically took tactics that were already in place and added the military tactic of bounding overwatch, mm-hmm. and put the two together. And we didn't come up with a name with it. Well, the deputy chief at the time who was in charge of training, her last name was MacArthur. Hmm. So
as in the assistant chief MacArthur?
Yes.
Okay.
So while they were getting ready to do this, and this is the way I understand it, so I should probably preface it by saying that. When they get ready to do this press release, whatever presser, that to announce these capabilities that we have, they're like, we don't have a name for this shit. Well, she's going to do the – and so the guy that created the tactic, who I know very well, said, hey, why don't we call it MACTAC, MacArthur Tactics.
Okay.
So that's where the name came from.
Oh, there you go.
And then they went, yeah, we can't tell people that. That just sounds stupid. Right? So they were like, okay, well, wait a minute. Let's go multi-assault counter. Oh, I got it. Multi-assault counterterrorism action capabilities. So our team, or actually division, started to train the whole department. And Correct. Then we actually trained a cadre that then took over and fucked it all up. So it's so watered down now that, yeah.
Well, this was several years ago. Yeah. And again, you know, you have these people that are running the show that can actually confidently stand out there and listen to something like that happen and say, hey, you know, SWAT, they have all the weapons and they get trained for this. It's not my job to go in there.
Right. But here, this is what I was going back to, is that, to use Columbine as a perfect example, Columbine is probably one of the most misunderstood events in modern history as far as police and schools and shooting and active shooter and all that stuff. It didn't start out, for those of you that don't know, it did not start out as an active shooter incident. It wasn't intended to be an active shooter incident. It wasn't even intended to be a mass shooting. It's a failed bombing.
Right.
Right. A lot of people don't understand. Columbine is a failed bombing. Their intent was to blow up the cafeteria, causing the library on top of it to come crashing down on everybody eating in the cafeteria. Then once people started fleeing the school, they would flee out through the parking lot where the two assholes, suspects, were waiting, and they
misunderstood youth.
Yes. These two misunderstood youths, the two youths, would use interlocking fields of fire to kill all the students fleeing from the school. And then when the police arrived, they would shoot it out with the police. And then once they were taken down, they were going to arm the bombs in their car for a 30-minute timer. So once the police and medics started going into the parking lot, a second bomb would go off, killing all the... It was going to be horrific. And luckily, they were two misunderstood youths who didn't know how to execute it. I think the EOD guy said that had they set off those bombs, they were going to explode probably 10 times bigger than what they intended them to do.
Wow.
So that being said, as law enforcement, what we learned from Columbine was you can't, when people are dying, you can't
hesitate.
You can't set up a perimeter and call SWAT, because they got flack, and in my opinion, rightfully so, for having a shitload of good guys with guns outside of the school while two bad guys, two 17-year-old fuckheads with guns, are killing innocent students and a teacher. Right. Well, but if you go back to what is arguably our first active shooter incident, which is at least the first one we can all think of as common pop culture reference, is the sniper in the Texas University bell tower.
Charles Whitman.
Mm-hmm. How did that end? Anybody remember?
A janitor and a police officer.
Right. And they individually, independent of one another, said, he's killing people.
I have to do something.
Right. I'm going to storm the fucking tower and take him out.
Yeah.
And they did.
One of which had absolutely no training or guns.
Right. Yeah. Right. None whatsoever. Yeah. So,
but ironically enough, I don't think we've ever figured out how he got his balls through the fucking door to get to the observation deck. I think he had to turn sideways to do that. So,
yeah. But if you look at, so you contrast that with the way Columbine was handled, the quote unquote, I say, lessons learned from it, and then the shift in teaching, which was no longer, okay, if there's an active shooter, if some people are actively getting killed, it's not a static situation. You, like you said, you're full speed ahead, you hear screaming, you move towards it. Well, now you have a situation where instead of just being patrol guys that are relying on SWAT, and that's why they're, you know, standing back and waiting, now you have patrol guys that are afraid of getting fucked by the lieutenant who says, no, you're not going to break the door down and go in. So it's almost, we've come full circle a second time to where good guys are supposed to do good guy things. And that, I mean, you look at the video I just posted on our Instagram of the SWAT team taking out the bad guy on the balcony. Mm-hmm. I mean, that was brilliant. It was mm-hmm. beautifully executed, mm-hmm. no pun intended. And yet we are raising this whole generation of cops. They're afraid to do that. They're afraid to take that level of direct action and responsibility and say, consequences be damned, I'm doing the right thing.
And as far as, besides being scared, I think also police officers in general, and I could say as being a police officer in a newer generation, for me, I never had fear of getting in trouble because I always knew I was doing the right thing. But what it became was the repetitive having to explain myself to everyone every single time I did something when it was a no-brainer.
Yeah.
Like, hey, I probably sat in front of two sergeants, a lieutenant, a deputy chief, and then at some point I was supposed to sit in front of the chief and it never happened. Because we had a call to a suicide in progress with a female that was 14 years old that was actively attempting to kill herself by overdose. Get to the house, the front door is glass. It's like, fuck, I can't kick through this. I'm going to fuck myself up. So I went running to the side of the door, booted the first door in, and then got into the second one, booted the second door in. Long story short, we ended up finding her. I hate
you left out all the good parts. Ended up
fighting her.
Yeah, yeah. No, so, but the point is I had to explain myself to multiple people on why I kicked in a door.
Yeah.
Are you kidding me?
Well, yeah.
That doesn't make it that in itself doesn't make sense to me. Why am I explaining myself to you? Would you have not done the same thing? What if that was your 14-year-old girl in there?
Maybe they wouldn't have.
I mean, it's insane to me. Yeah. So it's just more of the repetitive, like, fuck, dude, now I have to explain myself to you why I did what I feel like everybody else should be doing. Not that I'm scared to lose my job. Fuck you, I'll fight it. Yeah. Whatever. But I think also that mentality comes from my past, you know. So not a lot of people that just kind of grew up, I guess, in normal households and never did anything prior to law enforcement, and now this is their first like view of this stuff. I could see the fear setting in probably pretty quickly.
So I use the analogy of changing a tire in the rain. I think if you walked into the majority of police academy classes and you say, "Hey, how many of you guys have changed a flat tire in the rain?"
Mm.
And probably about half of them wouldn't. Right. Yeah. I call AAA. Yeah, and that's really what it boils down to, is that, you know, we were raised by people that taught us to do these kinds of things mm-hmm. ourselves. Mm-hmm. You know, if your tire's flat, you get out, you find the jack, you know, you no get AAA. Wet, it's dark.
Right.
You know, mm-hmm. nowadays kids sit in their car and they call AAA and somebody comes and does it for them. And that equates to the same thing in law enforcement. If you know, just like these guys that I was talking about, you're faced with something, but instead of doing something about it, they got on the radio.
Yeah.
Well, and called other AAA, people. CHP shows up. So
that's true. That is true.
You're right.
Well. But you know, it's I'll tell somebody on the radio what's going on, and they'll tell me what to do.
And how do you break that cycle? Because now you have the command staff that is now teaching younger officers, this is how you need to be.
Compulsory military service. Is
my solution. Oh, let's not go there. That's
another episode. Yeah.
Let's not go there.
You know, but you're right. There's a certain level of, you know, patrol guys setting up a perimeter and calling SWAT is the equivalent of calling AAA, right? You kick the can down the road, right?
We prefer 911, but I'll yeah, whatever.
But
whatever,
but it's the analogy. Your analogy holds up, right? Yeah. Because if you're scared to get out and do it yourself because either you've never been taught or you don't have the gumption to just say, I know I've never been taught, but fuck it, I'll take a chance. I'm pretty competent in most other things. I'm pretty fucking sure I can figure out how to change a tire in the rain, and I have too much pride and dignity to call a tow truck to do it for me. That doesn't exist.
Yeah.
I think to pride and dignity are probably the key words in that one.
You know, and I think it's out there. I mean, I think it's out there, but the police departments have a way of sucking it out of you.
Well,
man.
That's true.
The bureaucracy. It's just like Zohan said. It's like, how many times do you have to do the right thing and get your pee pee slapped
before you just say screw it?
I'm just not gonna do it anymore. Yeah. If I do nothing, I can't be punished for doing something.
You know, 7 years in, I was ready to be done.
Yeah. Yeah,
well, you look at the guys in Baltimore. They learned real quick.
Oh, the guys that got filed on?
Yeah, they learned real fucking quick. I'm not going to do anything.
Yeah.
I'm going to respond to the calls you send me to, mm-hmm. and I'm going to do just enough to not get in trouble.
Yeah, exactly.
And if you fang people for taking initiative, then they're going to stop taking initiative.
Yeah.
Well, and then you have the millennial mentality of the new officers coming on. So you do have a salty dude that's on patrol that tells some new guy what the fuck's up, and what do they do? They go tell on
you. They go tell on you.
Are you fucking serious? So you got it from all angles.
Yeah.
I blame the fact that we got rid of hazing.
Yeah.
I do.
Yeah. Episode 6 of War Stories.
Thank God I'm retired.
Yeah. Oh. Okay. Well, so now, as a female police officer, you've heard a lot of us talking about this stuff. Is there a perspective on it that we're not seeing?
From a female point of view?
Yeah. Or is there something that as guys we're beating our chests and all that stuff and you're going, hey guys, you're missing the point. But or is it as a female officer, you're like, fuck those pussies. I'm curious.
I don't think I understand the question.
Well, is there a different
still can't
point
get
of
past
view?
The fact that you said pussy and like look her right in the eye.
I'm still cringing on that.
No, is there a different? You're
talking to someone that's broken her radio on people's heads.
That's,
so go on.
Exactly. So I look at her as tough as nails and hard, dyed in the wool, hardcore. But I also don't. I can never imagine and deal with the things that you've seen from your perspective. So I'm just trying to get.
I don't think it's a female perspective. I think it's just time on the job and no time on the job. I think things are changing.
Right.
I think we're giving. The citizens what they want, and maybe it is just the vocal minority, but there's so much politics involved. It's all coming from the top down. So once you're a sergeant, once you're a lieutenant, and it's about politics, they're making the decisions that the vocal minority wants them to make. So they don't want us to do police work anymore. That's the bottom line.
So that's coming from the same perspective, which is you got to do the job if you're going to be allowed to, then, and if you're not going to be allowed to, then why try?
I don't know why they get it out of their cars anymore, really.
Yeah.
I don't know why they do. Some of them still do.
Yeah. Yeah, they're still out there.
A lot of them do.
Yeah.
A lot of them do. Yeah. And it's a shame because those are the guys that are walking on thinner and thinner ice every day, just doing the right thing.
Right.
Yeah. That's the problem.
It's sad. What has come to it's sad.
Go ahead.
Do you see a U-turn on the horizon at all?
No.
Or do you just see it going further and further down?
No.
Anybody?
They used to tell us, I think, and you guys have all heard the term, the pendulum swings.
Right.
And the theory was, and I've always heard it for 25 years, is that the pendulum can only swing so far.
Right.
And it's going to swing back. I don't think it's got to the limit yet.
No.
I think it's broken. It's just rolling away.
Yeah.
That's kind of what I was thinking. The pendulum is actually broken, and it's going to take somebody making a new pendulum or something.
I don't know. I think
it's going to take like, we're going to the purge.
Yeah, so it's kind of like.
Remember that whole duty ammo, 50 stamps?
Do you remember I told you when I said I look at her as a certified dyed in the wool badass?
The purge.
Yeah.
That's going to happen.
I'm all for it.
In the end, you let something get too far, you can't repair it.
Right.
It's like the homeless population in Los Angeles.
Right.
You let it get so far. Let's say they did righteously want to fix it. You can't. It's impossible to fix it.
It's
now.
Too late.
It's too late.
You know, the only thing that's going to fix it is a flamethrower.
Yeah. And your solution, some attorney will drop down out of
just
the sky and sue you for your solution.
Exactly. Yeah. That's money for them.
Yeah.
Right.
Of course.
Yeah.
Well, that was an uplifting episode of War
Stories.
Yeah,
that went south as usual.
No, it was great. I mean, the key part that we heard
was there a story? I don't remember. Did we even hear a story?
No. So the bad guys got their comeuppance at some point. Do you know what they got? Obviously, they got
charged
with
rape. They probably got a ticket.
Yeah, they got a ticket. Yeah, for speeding.
Restorative justice.
They got probation.
Oh, I don't know. Because I learned, and you guys probably did years ago, that once you slam the jail door, you don't want to know what happens because it will just suck the life right out of you.
It will eat you.
It will. I mean, you just.
DAs get elected. That's the hard word there is elected.
Mm-hmm. Oof.
The things you'll do to stay elected.
Yeah.
So. Right. Well, anybody closing thoughts for this episode with JR before we
No. Thank God I'm retired.
Right.
Every day is Saturday.
Every day is Saturday.
Right. That's right. LAPDonline.com. We are hiring. benefits, good starting salary.
You know, on those lines, though, it's so sad now when someone tells me that they want to come on the job.
Yeah. Because, you know, and I think still, like, I equate it to your child. Like, if your kid goes, Dad, I want to be a cop. And you go, fuck, I raised you right.
But
now it's terrible. Right.
But yeah, there's somewhere in middle America that's looking for you, and don't go to a big city. Don't, you know, just God bless your heart.
Yeah. I talked about it on the previous episode. I had a romance growing up with LAPD, Adam 12 and all that. So watching my dad go to work. I think when I was 7, I was handing out radios in the kit room at West Valley.
Yeah.
Just because it was take your kid to work day or whatever the hell. And then, you know, when it finally came time to get on the job, it was, son, go anywhere but there. I will help you, but please don't go there. And then even 3 years in, when I went to apply to lateral, the guys at the front counter, sworn officers working the desk at Parker Center, and they're like, why are you here? And I was like, I was going to lateral. Well, where are you from? And I told them, and they go, don't fucking come here, man. Don't fucking do it. Yeah. And I went, holy shit. And I walked out of that whole polygraph exam at Parker Center and all that, and I kind of walked out of there with the 1,000-yard stare that you had, Zohan, when you walked in today. And it's just like, what the fuck am I doing? And I went home and I went, honey, it's not happening. It was the most eye-opening experience.
But, you know, I kind of equate it to my time in the Marine Corps. It's like, you know, you think about it your whole life, and you finally get in, and then while you're there, you're like, what the fuck was I thinking? This sucks, right? And then when you're done,
right,
and you go anywhere in the world and you tell somebody that's what you did, they look at you with they look at you a different way.
Yeah,
and you go, wow, thank you. God, I hate this term. Thank you for your service. But yeah, I mean, that's what we did. It was a calling. It was a calling for each and every one of us, and we're all doing it. And that's something that no one can ever take away from us. And, you know, we talked about hostage counts and all that earlier, I'm sorry. And, you know, every single one of us can remember that radio call, you know, that we went to, and there was a little kid crying, and in the corner.
Mm-hmm.
And that little kid is alive, or that little kid remembers that cop that came through the front door and changed his life.
Yep.
So all this bullshit that we talk about, that's all it is bullshit.
Right.
Right. Every single one of us has touched somebody's life. 14-year-old girl, you know, every single one of us has touched somebody's life, and we changed it, and we changed it for the better. Okay. And fuck, we got paid while we were doing it. So, you know, what more could you ask for out of life, right?
And we hang on to that, because that's ultimately, we can bitch, we can moan, we can complain. And we've been doing it for an hour now. And when this episode comes out, everyone's going to be like, why the fuck would I even do? No, I'm going to tell you right now, nothing I've ever felt is quite the same as actually being a force for good in somebody's life and knowing that they're either alive or that the course of their life has been drastically altered for the better because you spent an hour in it.
Yeah.
Just sometimes not even that. Sometimes you spend 20 minutes in somebody's life and it's forever altered. And I've been on the receiving end once or twice of meeting that person a couple years later. And I think we've talked about this. It's something we should be better at as law enforcement, military, firefighting. We should be better at making sure that those things happen, because that's the fuel. That's that soul uplifting spiritual moment where that's going to keep you going. And if people don't get to see that, it's just going to keep getting worse and worse and worse, because they're not going to see, no, you guys don't understand. This guy may have gotten his ass kicked and his face may be lumped up, and you may feel bad for this poor guy, but instead of showing you the guy with his lumped up face, let's show you the girl he lumped up. Let's show you the kid he was touching. Let's show you the freaking gal in the Macy's that he raped. Let's show you those people. Let's show you the bad guy. Let's show you their victims, so you can start seeing the evil that they're doing, not the face of evil after they get their shit pushed in by the good guys. So,
yeah,
that's my...
Now we just got to figure out how to way to play this episode backward.
Doesn't always end like that.
Yeah. So, till our next episode, which will be we're going to start doing weekly as soon as we have a back catalog, because we try to knock out a couple episodes at a time because we're all busy people.
Yeah. But we're getting close. We're getting close.
We're getting close to be releasing every Monday. And I've actually, this was interesting feedback. I have a coworker during my normal day job who walked into work Monday morning on a Monday where we don't release and looked me square in the face and goes, where's my episode? Yeah, and I went, it's every other Monday. And he goes, damn you. And so I said, no, soon. So the more feedback we get, the more subscribers, the more we'll be able to crank these out even faster. But until our next episode of Strong Drinks and True Lies, #StrongDrinksTrueLies, come home with your shield or on it.